Hello everyone and welcome back as we conclude our look at the CloudWatcher software. So far we've looked at the common controls and indications and the first four tabs, which were all about displaying the CloudWatcher data, defining conditions and setting unsafe conditions and alarms. The setup tab, as its name suggests, allows us to tailor the many variables of the CloudWatcher to our needs. You might feel a little overwhelmed when confronted with the many settings on this page, but most are logical and you probably won't need many of the advanced settings when starting out. Before I go any further, if you are watching this video in the hope of learning about advanced topics such as the K factors and sky temperature adjustments, then I'm afraid you're going to be disappointed. We intend to make a separate video on this subject, and we know that it is an area of interest for a lot of users. However, to keep this video to a reasonable length, I'm going to concentrate on an overview of the settings and the most important information for users starting out with the CloudWatcher. As we saw with the Graphs tab, the Setup tab also has a number of secondary tabs on the right-hand side. We're going to start, logically enough, with the first of these, the Setup Device tab. Not to be confused with the Device tab in the main display, which will be discussed later. At the very top, we have the settings that we saw in Video 2 to select a COM port and test that it's working. The cycle is the time between CloudWatcher readings, and the timeout is the time allowed for the CloudWatcher to respond or to update its data file in remote mode. There should normally be no need to change these values. The unit section allows for various combinations of common measurement units to be selected according to your region and preferences. The altitude field is used by CloudWatchers with an atmospheric pressure sensor to convert the measured pressure to mean sea level. The rain sensor heater controls are a frequent source of questions, and as with the sky temperature correction factors below, you are advised not to change these unless you need to. The parameters in red can all be modified, and the manual contains a description of their purpose. I'll pause briefly on the sky temperature correction factors just to point out a less than obvious feature that reveals itself when you right-click on the area marked factors. This opens a graph that allows you to better visualize changes made to the K factors. Once again, the manual contains more details about this feature. The next section allows you to enable or disable the CloudWatcher's switch. This has the potential to cause some confusion, and I want to spend a moment to explain this. Right now, the CloudWatcher is indicating safe, and the switch state is open and green. This makes sense. I'm now going to cause an unsafe state by clicking the Overcast button on the Unsafe tab. As you can see, the CloudWatcher now reports unsafe and the switch is closed. Again, this is the behaviour that you would no doubt expect. But what happens if I deselect the switch, restart the CloudWatcher, and the weather then becomes safe? The switch retains the position it was in when it was disabled. This might not be the behaviour that you desire, and therefore care should be taken when disabling the switch if you are relying on its output to control other equipment. The safe condition delay period is a very useful feature that imposes a delay to the announcement of the safe state. A good example of its use might be in windy conditions, where there might be several seconds or minutes between gusts. In this case, you might choose a long delay of perhaps 1800 seconds to be certain that the winds have actually died down before opening the roof and continuing with the observation. I'm going to use a 10 second delay to illustrate the effect. The cloud alarm delay is another very useful feature, and in a sense the mirror image of the safe condition delay period. The setting imposes a delay to an unsafe condition caused specifically by the cloud warning, and its purpose is to avoid a small amount of cloud causing a session to abort. As you're no doubt aware, The standard CloudWatcher consists of an infrared sky temperature sensor, which can be augmented by the atmospheric pressure and relative humidity sensor. All three of these individual sensors can also produce an output of ambient temperature. Versions of the CloudWatcher software up to and including 9.2 allowed you to choose the source of the ambient temperature information. However, the latest software release has removed this choice, and the unit will now use the relative humidity sensor if available, or alternatively the output from the infrared sensor. We have, however, retained the temperature offset section, which allows you to apply a compensation to the ambient or IR temperatures. The last section of this page is for users of the anemometer. At present, there are two types of anemometer in use, the grey one being the older version. If you have reason to suspect that your wind readings are other than expected, please check that you have the correct selection in this field. We now turn to the Graphs tab. You'll recall from the previous video that the CloudWatcher has the ability to produce graphs at periodic intervals, and this behaviour is controlled from here. As you can see, this tab has a horizontal scroll bar to give access to all seven available graphs. The first line, Create, dictates whether the graph appears on the Graphs tab. If a graph is deselected here, the associated image file is no longer available. In the next line, the number of data points and readings can be adjusted. The default settings are 120 points, with each point created every 6 cycles. We know from the Setup Device tab that the default cycle time is 10 seconds, and the time span is the product of the number of points, the frequency, and the cycle. This is the x-axis of the graph, and varying any of the 3 components will cause this time to change. The label and graph colours can be selected by right-clicking on the respective fields, and for most graphs, the background and y-axis limits are predetermined. You may recall from the previous video that the temperature graph has a slightly different format, and this is reflected in the available options on this tab. The image file line allows us to choose which image files are created for the respective graph. The next line specifies the file format of the images. It might appear that PNG is the only available format, but deselecting this option selects JPEG together with its quality settings. At the very bottom of this selection, the path setting allows you to specify the location of the graph image files. The Setup Alarm tab has as its first line a field to suspend the sound alarms. Please note that if this box is checked, there will be no further indication on the Unsafe tab. The audio alarm will simply fail to play. Therefore, great care should be taken when using this field if you plan to use the audio alarms feature. The next section enables the definition of conditions that are classed as unknown. These might arise due to sensor failures or problems with the communication via the serial connection between the CloudWatcher and the host computer or solo. In general, you probably won't need to change any of these settings, and the only decision will be whether you wish to treat an unknown failure as unsafe. This is a personal choice, although we would always recommend erring on the side of caution and leaving this field checked. We've already met the Setup Network tab in the second video on setting up the CloudWatcher. And now it's time to take a closer look. We already know that we can toggle between master and remote modes here. We also know how to set the path for the parameters transfer file. Below this is a similar field for the user data file that we discussed when looking at the common controls and indications. You'll recall that this is the file that is created when we select Record Start on the left-hand side of the user interface. You'll also recall that the CloudWatcher defaults to saving its data in the installation directory, and that recent Windows additions do not allow writing to this directory. So you will need to choose an alternative write-enabled destination, such as your Documents folder. As well as specifying the path to this file, we can change its name and determine how frequently the file is written. Under File Structure, we can manipulate the file's content and the order of that content. There is an option to record the last reading only or to create a debug file. Care should be taken if using the debug option, as the file could grow quite large over time. The last sections of this tab allow the path for the single line data file and the JSON format files to be specified. The name of the single line data file can be amended, whilst the JSON file has a fixed name. The JSON file is required if you wish to use the Lunartico ASCOM safety monitor. The final subsection of the setup tab is the script section. This will only be of interest to a small minority of users, as normally the safe, unsafe condition will be monitored by your imaging software via the ASCOM safety switch and actions taken accordingly. If, for some reason, your software doesn't support the safety switch and you don't have a dragonfly, the CloudWatcher offers the facility to trigger scripts when it changes from safe to unsafe and vice versa. Please contact us via the user forum if you are interested in using scripts with your CloudWatcher. We've covered a lot of ground in this third part of the video series, and there's just one more tab to consider. You may never need to look at the device tab, as it contains mainly technical information to help us troubleshoot in the case of problems. The top of the tab does, however, contain some important information in the form of the serial number and the current firmware version. There is also a summary on the left-hand side of the output of the CloudWatcher sensors. That concludes our look at the CloudWatcher software. Part 4 of the series will look at the Solo's user interface in more detail. So if you own or are thinking of acquiring a Solo, please join me next time for that. To keep up to date with future video releases, please subscribe to our channel. And if you have any questions, you can visit our forum and leave us a message. Thank you for watching, and goodbye.